Good morning, everyone. So, so if you look at the current cloud market, cloud world, there are a lot of PaaS vendors are playing around. So, in this session, I will cover what are the essential elements that you may think about choosing PaaS your business need. And meanwhile, I'll go to the Apache Stratos architecture and see explain how the Apache Stratos cater this enterprise requirement that in element, essential element in the platform as services. Okay, first of all, this is my background. So I'm an architect at WSO2, and so I'm a committer and PMC member of Apache Stratos. I have 12-plus year experience in industry, and mainly working on 6-plus year in cloud computing. I co-founded a company in 2005, mainly focusing on cloud computing. This is my family. Okay, so if we, there's some, I list down the elements that I think we should have in enterprise PaaS. So so I will go to the detail in the in session. So if I go to one by one, so the one is open extendable architecture. That is very important because if this if the open and extendable architecture, you can not limited to a choose platform, you can extend, you can customize your platform to your need. That's very important. Then the intelligent capacity on demanding and the multi-factored auto-scaling. So these are the very important, if you, the PaaS features, if you're taking a platform as services, this auto-scaling, the capacity on demanding is the main feature. So you need to think about these elements, how the platform as services are providing this technology. Then the another thing is a multi-tenancy. So I will explain in detail. So that is a very important factor if you are going to deploy a public cloud, like a 100,000 or million of customers going to use that platform. That is very important. So likewise, I will go to each and every section in detail in future slides. First of all, I will explain the Stratos architecture. This is some kind of layered architecture. So here you can see there are several layers. So the bottom, there's an infrastructure as service layer. So Stratos can run top of multiple infrastructure as services like OpenStack, CloudStack, vCloud, EC2, private or public cloud. So we top of that, we are using jCloud layer. So with the jCloud, we can support 40 plus IaaS. That's jCloud was an Apache project. So theoretically, if the jCloud support any IaaS, Stratos also can support with this abstraction. Then if you have the middle layer, there's a core components of Apache Stratos. We have Cloud Stratos Manager, managing all the aspect and exposing REST API to rest of the world. And there's a cloud controller who control the underlying IaaS. And the autoscaler is responsible for scaling up, scaling down based on the requirement. And we have CLI command line interface, web interface. And artifact distribution coordinator is mainly responsible for distributing your artifact among these deployed cartridges. I will explain what are the cartridges. Then complex event processor. So it is a real-time analyzing engine. So you can analyze the every health stat in real time and summarize, that will help to the autoscaler to take a decision at accurate manner. Then Stratos foundation layer provides some default services like load balancing, then identity service like tenant creation, login, SSO, and the metering service. These are the base framework services that provide from Stratos layer. Then top layer. The top layer is very important. This is a cartridge layer. So that is the runtime entity of Stratos. So previous I explained the deployment and entities. So after deploy your Stratos, you can bring any your language cartridges or any your application cartridges to the as a runtime entity of Stratos as a cartridge. So I will explain in detail. So if I look at the L1 architecture kind of thing, so you can see Stratos use this message bus to communicate all the components. So we have unified communication method. And we use the real-time engine bus. We use TRIP protocol, the CEP, getting all the health stat periodically publishing by the every instances, and CEP can analyze in real time and summarize this information to help to auto scale. So the top layer is a service layer. So the service is a cartridge. So you can it can have 1 to N nodes based on the scale of that cartridge, and load balancers also can have 1 to N kind of thing. We can have service level load balancer or global load balancers, depending on the requirement that you need. So this is a very complex diagram, but I put here. So we have unified the communication basic PubSub via GMX protocol. So that means anyone can extend this very easily. There's no proprietary thing. So just only teams subscribe to these topics and get information of that, and you can extend whatever you need to do. So I will explain. With this, we can bring any kind of load balancers into Stratos. That's a very important part, because normally if you choose a pass, you are limited to that particular pass provide load balancers. So that is not very good. So with this topology topic, subscribe publish mechanism, you can bring any third-party load balancers easily doing some extension we are already shipping. So you can see all the communication in PubSub. So what I want to put it here. So we have unified communication mechanism across the platform. So these are the cartridges. So like so Stratos is a polyglot pass. What I say polyglot means you can bring framework cartridges, language cartridges, database cartridges. You name it, you can bring it as a cartridge. So that's another important part. So is this cartridge model, you can bring your own legacy application to the cloud. So what is the benefit of that? So if you bring your legacy application to the cloud, it can benefit from the underlying PaaS features like scaling, logging, centralized logging, all the features you can benefit it. So that's very important. So you can the many businesses need their legacy application to bring to the cloud. So that's the entry point. If you use Stratos, you can bring your own legacy application as a cartridge. Okay, so if I summarize what's the value of this architecture, the cartridge model itself, so that's a very valuable architecture in Stratos. You can bring your legacy application. Then we have unified all communication and it pops up JMX protocol. And Stratos PaaS provide the centralized logging framework. So that's very important. I will explain why it's important if you deploy 100,000 of nodes. Otherwise, the DevOps life is very hard to do monitoring these aspects. Then using JCloud APIs, we can plug multiple IASs, and this can be simultaneously run multiple top of multiple IASs. That's also very important. And using this topology PubSub mechanism, we can bring any third-party load balancers into Stratos architecture. And you can plug your own health monitoring like Nagios, Gangila, Sabix, or any monitoring system into the, this architecture, and based on this statistics, you can do the auto scaling in very easy manner. Okay, so next thing is the scalable and dynamic load balancing. So, how we scale it? Theoretically, it's infinite scale because we are doing horizontal scaling. So, practically, depending on the under an IAS resources that you can spin up instances. And so how dynamic is Stratos load balancing? So Stratos load balancer also considered as a cartridge. That means they can dynamically spin up as it need. And this load balancer can itself auto scale. So that means there's no bottleneck, single load balancer. Load balancer can auto scale to serve in the required load. Then if you deploy a multi-cloud, multi-region deployment, so we can deploy load balancers for a particular region, cloud. That's NAS and our bottleneck. So that's if you update the your round robin DNS, it can easily serve in our request. Then we can define load balancers per service cluster. Like I mentioned, if you define a PHP service cluster, if you want to define a separate load balancer for that PHP service cluster, you can easily define. And if you want another service cluster define like a MySQL service cluster, you can easily define, okay, I need another load balancer, MySQL, separate load balancer, MySQL service cluster. Likewise, it is very flexible. You can define service level load balancing. Okay, so what is the unique in Stratos? So this Cartridge model, it's you can auto scale load balance itself. And with this message broker, PubSub mechanism, you can bring any load balancers into Stratos. HAProxy, Nginx, Amazon AWS, load, ELB. So this is very important because if you want to deploy your PaaS in Amazon cloud, EC2 cloud, so they have owned their load balancer, Elastic load balancer. They have optimized their load balancer to work on their Amazon cloud. So if we use another load balancer in Amazon cloud, that is, we can't optimize at that level. So that is very important. If you deploy in Amazon EC2, we can use their Elastic load balancer to do the load balancing. Likewise, it's very flexible. Depending on the requirement, you can bring your own load balancer to the Stratos. So here, you can see that all the member information are in this topology topic. So it is only all the cloud control is published, all the member information to the topology topic. Then there's an extension we are providing. It subscribe for this topology and get the member information. Then what only need is you need to update your load balance endpoint with this member information. Okay, next thing is multi-factored auto-scaling. What is this multi-factor auto-scaling? Normally, a lot of PaaS only providing HTTP-based auto-scaling. In Stratos, we can have HTTP as well as non-HTTP-based auto-scaling. So for example, so we need, in Stratos, we can have load average-based auto-scaling, memory consumption-based auto-scaling. You can write your own logic to get the application load, and based on that, we can do the auto-scaling. And then the HTTP base, like lower, the in-flight request count in the load balancer, take on that parameters as auto scale. So like this algorithm can work multiple factors taken one time, and based on this all the factors, it can analyze, and based on one or two factors, it can do the auto scale. So that's a very unique feature in Stratos. So because a lot of PaaS only have the HTTP based auto scaling, then only you can do the web-based application in auto-scaling. Then Stratos auto-scaler capable of predicting future load. So how it's doing is that, so every cartridges publish its information. We can configure every 10 second, every 30 second, every 15 second. It can we can configure to publish to the CEP via TRIF protocol. So then the CEP, complex event processor, it can configure, okay, within a time window, okay, we can call it 1 minute, it can analyze all this information coming to that CEP and summarize information and provide to the autoscaler, take a decision, predict the future load. So we are using this, you know, the motion equation. So it is a motion curve. So if I take that, for example, say load average based autoscaling. So every instance publish their load average every 10 seconds. Then CEP will aggregate all this statistic and create first derivative and second derivative of this load average within a 1 minute time window. Then it will pass this information to the autoscaler. Then using this equation, they can predict, okay, next minute, predicted load average with this service cluster. Then autoscaler can with the predicted value, it can scale up early to act on the future load. And this is a very important factor if you want to deploy autoscaling feature. So why should one care of this auto scaling? Basically, there's no need to have beforehand the capacity planning. It will do the capacity planning based on the resource. It will do the resource provisioning based on the load. So that's very important. So then there is the level of life is very easy. They are not panic whether this heavy load coming. They need to provision hardware, all this stuff. They can just monitor this stuff. Platform as a service will provide their capabilities. So, and it is very accurate capacity planning with these features. So here, so you can see all the health stats are published via TRIF protocol CEP. Then it will analyze all the all this information and send to the message broker via JMX protocol. Sorry, here I have missed some arrow. So here, autoscaler will subscribe this information and get this information and do the scaling algorithm. And based on that information, it will act on the autoscaling. Okay. The next thing is that the controlling IS resources. This is also very important. So here, Stratos, we have some terminology. So we have a call partition. So what is this partition? So DevOps can define this partition based on their IASs. For example, so say Amazon EC2 region, the west US West region, and available zone A or AB, you can define, OK, this is my partition 1. Then the available zone B, C is a partition 2. And you can define partition based on the IAS resources. Then this partition can use to define, OK, if I spin up instance, OK, this instance should spin up in this partition. The next instance should spin up in this partition. So we can control the IAS, that resources, very accurate manner. This is very important if you provide in cloud SLA. I will come and in the future side. Then the network partition. That's also very important definition in Stratos. So you can group whatever you define in the partition to a logical way of the network partition, define network partition. Say if you define a US West as one network partition, you can define, okay, this is a well-known 1, 2, 3 is my partition. I group into one network partition. Because what is important is Stratos can automate creating load balancers per network partition. So if you deploy your cartridge to network partition, it will automatically create a load balancer. Then load balancer has the public and private IPs. Then other cartridge only need to have private IPs. Only we can expose load balancer to the rest of the world. Then all the other communication are done in private IP in private secure way. And another fact is that so the Stratos autoscaler is intelligent to monitor load per network partition. See, if you deploy a multi-cloud deployment, so there's a traffic coming to the particular network partition, that is US West or East region. So the Stratos autoscaler can intelligently identify that, okay, there's a huge traffic come to this particular network partition. We should autoscale this network partition nodes to serve this request. Likewise, this network partition is very important. So it intelligently do the capacity on demanding using this network partition concept. So like I said, so what are the advantages? We can control the underlying IAS resources. We can define partition what we need in the requirement. And we can provide the high availability. We can provide the disaster recovery based on this partition. We can deploy one app in this partition, second app in this other partition. We can have a disaster recovery. And see, if you want to do a geolocational application, it's very important. You can define, okay, these are the location I need to deploy my application. Then there's smart policies. So Stratos has two smart policies. One is auto-scaling policy. Second is deployment policy. So auto-scaling policies define all the threshold value that need to be taken to the auto-scaling decision. For example, we can define, okay, the in-flight request count is 40 per second. my load average is say 75%. That kind we can define this threshold in your auto scaling policy. Then if when subscription time, there's a subscription happening in the cartridges, you can choose whatever this smart policy is to your subscription. So based on your requirement, you can choose different auto scaling policies. If you subscribe to a particular policy, then auto scaler take care of that. Okay, if when the values that need to be auto scale based on this your subscription defined in the auto scaling policy. Then the deployment policy. So deployment policy use this I explained the partition and the network partition. You can define your deployment policy based on this partition and network partition. Say I want to have a high available deployment. So in my deployment policy I can say okay, my first partition is Amazon EC2 US. My second network partition is Asia Pacific thing. And you can define okay, how many minimum instances should running in this particular partition. If you say 3 minimum instances, Shadows will take care of okay. With that application, you have 3 minimum running instances in that particular partition. Likewise, you can define your based on your requirement, you can define your deployment policies. Then users can use this policy when it's subscription time. So why should one care? So it's provide this cloud SLA. So then the application developer, no need to worry about this thing. So they can focus their domain knowledge is application development, they can focus on that. They need to no need to think about, okay, why we are to do, how the HA handling, how the this multi-cloud deployment happening, how the geo-based auto-scaling happening. They can pass that into the PaaS layer. They can just focus on their application development, and that's a very important part. And then in the DevOps life. So because if you deploy a multi-cloud in a multi-region application, the DevOps is life is very hard to monitor this whole aspect, and you need to monitor all the load coming to that particular region, and need to act on the scale provisioning this stuff. There's no need to worry about that. So they are all the requirement handled by the underlying platform as services. Okay, then the multi-tenancy. So Stratos provide two level of multi-tenancy. That is container multi-tenancy. Like we can take as a virtual instance or LXC or Docker container. Next thing, the in-container multi-tenancy. That is, within the container, you can define your own multi-tenancy. Because this is very important, like I said, so if you want to deploy a public cloud or whatever, very large cloud, that is need deploy using by 100,000 or million of tenants, you can go to the container multi-tenancy because it's very costly. But if you go to the in-container multi-tenancy, so your cost is very low. So Shadows can support both of these multi-tenancy. So advantages, you can optimize resource utilization and low footprint, and no need to have dedicated resources for particular tenants. The next thing is cloud bursting. So this is a very important aspect that if you want to use up PaaS platform as services. We'll take example. So say some company developer, say shopping cart application. So they are going to sell their products via this their website using this shopping cart. Then they need to host this. They have to provision the hardware in their data center or their private place. They have to provision hardware. So they need to think about, okay, how much of hardware I need to run this application. Then there's a seasonal times come, then Christmas time or maybe time. So there may be a huge traffic coming on. Then they need to think about, okay, how is that, how are we going to handle that kind of situation? Then they have to provision, either they have to provision, they have to expand their data center that handle that load. But if you have the cloud bursting capability, that's the cloud bursting coming on the picture. If you want to, with this cloud bursting, you can only define, okay, the average. You can define your resources to average load in your data center. Then particular seasons time or particular load peak time, you can burst into the public cloud or other cloud to do the resource load balancing. So this is very important. So with Stratos, you can have multiple cloud, multiple public cloud or private cloud or hybrid cloud. You can define, then any time if the request or peak time happening, you can burst into the this another cloud, and you are only you have to only pay for that particular running instance in that particular time. This is very important if you are choosing this kind of application. So so what is unique about Stratos is that, so if you deploying if you bursting into the this public cloud or whatever another cloud, so Stratos automatically create a load balancer for that particular cloud, because otherwise you are again bottlenecking your defined load balancer in your private region. It will go request you to handle to the private to public. So here Stratos can automatically deploy load balancers, and you can only thing is you can automate your DNS update using the round-robin DNS. It will update the two DNSs, which automatically handle the load balancing from the Stratos layer. That's very important aspect. Otherwise, lot of PaaS vendors doesn't support this feature, because again we are bottlenecking our load balancer inside in our on-premise deployments. Again, so what are the advantages? Dev applies easier and low cost of ownership. It only you had only pay for particular running time. So here, this diagram shows that. So every cloud, it will create, Stratos will take care of creating load balancers, and then the if you update the DNS, it will do the rest of the routing part, and it can do the scaling within that cloud. The next thing is that logging, metering, and monitoring. So in Stratos, every instance uptime, downtime, everything are logged. And also the application health or application logs are published to the centralized logging framework. So this is very important. So say if you have deploy hundred of nodes to a particular application, then there's a issue coming, or we need to debug something. So then you have to log in every instance and see, okay, what is the issue in that particular instance. That's a nightmare. So with this Stratos, it provides the centralized logging capability. There's a filtering, there's a UI. Then you can just search on that and see, okay, what is the error and what is the node. Then you can only centralized thing, if you can look at that, you can go to the debugging mode to that particular instance. So that is a very important aspect. And then metering. And and metering and monitoring. So with this centralized logging capability, we can very easily total the totally. We can do the very easily totally, because we have centralized information. We can just use look at that logging thing, and we can do the totaling part. So all these aspects provide one PaaS layer. So then application developer no need to worry about these things. They just want to concentrate their own their part. Okay, so these are the thing I want to discuss in this session. So Stratos is in incubating still incubating. So I think we good to graduate now. So there's we have to do the community voting. So so you can try out and you can join Stratos, and so then we can work together and make a great project. So any question I can take on? Yeah.
There are a couple quick questions about underlying technology. So in terms of the message broker and the pub sub model,
yeah,
what is your underlying
technology after that? Yeah, so we have two, actually we use a WSL message broker, and we are using other thing is ActiveMQ. So any message broker, any JMX based message broker we can use. There's no tie up it.
Okay, and one other follow up question. So, in terms of the centralized logging,
yeah,
and things like that, so if you have all these multiple instances out there, how would they aggregate those logs?
Yes. So, there's every instance we are deploying a Stratos agent. Okay. So, you can define, okay, these are the log files you need to monitor. it will aggregate all this log file and send the centralized login via TIFF protocol.